Thank you. right. Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to our service. I hope everyone has come in with their heart and their mind and their soul prepared to worship our Heavenly Father. Let's all stand together. Let us be filled with the Spirit and praise our Lord and our God this morning. We're going to start off by singing Trading My Sorrows.
I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness, I'm trading my pain, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. Sing, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. I'm pressed but not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. I'm blessed beyond the curse, for His promise will endure, that His joy's gonna be my strength. Though the sorrow may last for the night, the joy comes with the morning. I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness, I'm trading my pain, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. I'm pressed but not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. I'm blessed beyond the curse, for His promise will endure, that His joy's gonna be my strength. Though the sorrow may last for the night, His joy comes with the morning. I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness, I'm trading my pain, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. We sing, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. Sing, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord,
amen. Amen. Say yes to the Lord. Well, you may be seated. Pastor Nathan will come share announcements and open us up in prayer.
Well, good morning, everyone. It is a joy to gather with you this morning. I don't have a lot of announcements, but
okay, your microphone's on.
We good?
There we go.
Woohoo! Okay. Well, it's good to be with you, and just have a little bit of an update from the week, but I don't have a lot of further announcements. Had several different meetings this week, including a couple that are related to our community. And so I just wanted to update you with that because I've been bringing you announcements. So I met with the local area, the Woodstock Arleta Neighborhood Association on Wednesday. And then I met with our trustees, and we had a guest representative meet with us from the community on Thursday. And there's been a variety of approaches and working with the city and stuff to deal with the community area gun violence. And there's a lot of things associated with that, cars speeding and some of those kind of things. So you will have noticed that we have started blocking off parts of our parking lot during the middle of the week just to prevent cars from whipping in and utilizing the parking lot in that way. You can still get to the office areas just fine and those kinds of things. But that's one step that we've taken in conjunction with the community. We're looking into some camera tools, possibly some updated lighting, some of those kinds of things. The community has put in, had the city bring barrels to reduce the speeds in some off streets and make them local access only streets. That's not a fix within itself, but it does help slow down the traffic and make it less appealing for some of those dangerous activities. Just last Sunday, the community put on just a get-to-know-you event taking place in the park. The park has been a center for a lot of the dangerous activity recently, and so it was kind of a take-back-our-park and a get-to-know-you all at the same time. There were some fun things for the kids and an opportunity for people to get to know each other. We continue to listen to the community and to work together. It's been good to hear those voices and to lend a voice at times. The most recent decision involving us here at Tremont Church is we listened to a representative from the community, and they have requested to hold an event here in the east portion of our parking lot. The weekend isn't decided yet, but one of the first two weekends in November. So we will bring you updated information on that as it develops. They're looking at holding just kind of a walk-in neighborhood harvest party type of event. I don't have all the details yet, but I wanted to let you know so that you can be in prayer for that. We're just providing the space, but there may be opportunities for us to be involved as far as attending or even maybe hosting some game for children or something like that. So I'll try to keep you updated, and if you have ideas, I would love to hear your ideas also. It's been a season to stretch ourselves and get to know people outside of our own walls. And so I encourage you to join in doing that when you have time and opportunity, and to be good neighbors, good friends, to listen well and find out what's going on with people's hearts, because I believe that God still cares about each individual and uses us as his children to extend his grace and a listening ear, and when the moment's right, a word of wisdom that points them to the truth. So I encourage you to prayerfully consider and uphold and maybe participate in those things. With that all shared, let's take some time just to be with the Lord. So I'll give you some quiet moments just to be with him, reflect and pray, and then I'll close us in prayer in just a moment before we continue with our singing. Let's pray together. Thank you, Father, for inviting us into your presence to be quiet and still and rest in your goodness and your grace. Sometimes it is so palpable and present with us, and we just have a sense of your presence and your kindness and your work in our lives. And other times, Lord, it seems quiet and even veiled, and we can grow uncertain and waver in our faith. Lord, thank you that you promise to be near, whether we're feeling it or not, that you are close, that you do love, that you are consistent, and you are holding true to your covenant with your people, no matter what may come. We can trust your way and your plan and your actions. Lord, help us as we lift our worship to you, to lay aside the hindrances, the worries and fears and doubts of the day and of the week. Lord, may we let go of those areas where we failed in conversations, or we moved too quickly or too slowly. May we receive that you accept us and love us. God, if there's areas of sin, things that we need to turn from and move back in your direction and trust you and cling to you in the truth, Lord, may we not hold on to falsehood, to destruction, to sinful patterns, to selfishness, and hold on to it so tightly that it drag us to death. But Lord, may we let go of those things and turn our hearts to you. Help us as we engage with our community in sincere love. One, if that's not the case right now in our hearts, and we're still focused on differences and opinions and irritations, Lord, let us let those things and allow you to take them and be in control. And then, God, with sincere hearts, help us to engage in the world around us, demonstrating your grace, your tactfulness, your wisdom, offering stability, offering vulnerability of our own lives and a faithful testimony. And when the moment is made available to us, pointing people to the truth of your word and your way, that they might know that you are bigger than the brokenness of this world and that you love them too. God, use us for your glory. We love you, and it's a joy for us to worship you this morning. In your name, amen.
Amen. Well, I'd like to invite you to stand once again. Let us continue to worship our Lord through music. We got a couple of fun songs we're going to sing.
The wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, will sing and shout the victory. And while we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sigh. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. And let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. And a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. I have lied in my soul for which long I have sought since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart. From my wandering and going astray, since Jesus came into my heart. And my sins, which were many, are all washed away, since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart. There's a light in the valley of death now for me. Since Jesus came into my heart. And the gates of the city beyond I can see. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart.
Last verse.
I shall go there to dwell in that city I know. Since Jesus came into my heart. And I'm happy, so happy as onward I go. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart.
That's true for you.
I know not why God's wondrous grace
to me had made known, nor why I'm worthy. Christ in love redeemed me for his own. But I know whom I have believed in, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. I know not how this saving faith to me did impart, nor how believing in his word brought peace within my heart. But I know I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I committed unto him against that day. I know not how the Spirit moves, convincing men of sin, revealing Jesus through the Word, creating faith in him. But I know I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I committed unto him against that day. I know not when my Lord may come at night or noonday fair, nor if I'll walk up there with him or meet him in the air. But I know I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. But I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Amen. Well, this last song we're going to sing today is actually a new song to our church, and it's called Resurrecting. And my son calls it the victory song, because victory is a main word in the chorus. But anyway, I really like the opening first verse. It talks about Jesus, whose head was once crowned with thorns, is now crowned in glory, as he is the King of Kings. And the Savior who knelt to wash our feet, now at his feet we bow. So let's sing this song. Here's how it goes.
That once was crowned with thorns is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet, now at his feet we bow. The one who wore our sin now robed in majesty, the radiance of perfect love now shines for all to see. Your name is victory. All praise will rise. Your name
fear that held us now gives way to Him who is our peace. His final breath upon the cross is now alive in me. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. The tomb where soldiers watched in vain was borrowed for 3 days. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the grave. Our God has robbed the your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. You may be seated. Pastor Nathan will come share today's message.
Good morning, everyone. Some of our kiddos are headed downstairs and other places, so we'll let them make their way out. We're going to be continuing working our way through the narrative of Genesis today. And as I hinted at 2 weeks ago, we have made it to chapter 6. We're actually going to take a peek at little portions of chapters 6, 7, and 8 today. And as we walk through this narrative, as we pull out key highlights from it, that last song really captured what I would hope for you, which is as we look at this story or this account of what took place, I would love if we could, with our mind's eye, with our heart, have a vantage point of looking through the story, but keeping our eyes fixed on that resurrected King who is resurrecting you and I. Because that's really the story. The story of the gospel in these early pages of Scripture and what's going on in the world. Would you first go with me in prayer as we prepare our hearts? Lord Jesus, thank you for this time that you've allowed us to set aside and be safe and comfortable and present together, whether we be watching from home or on a device or sitting here in the room this morning. God, thank you for your word. Thank you for what you have done throughout history, that you have never turned your back on us, that you have never turned away from your mission to draw us back to yourself since those early days when sin first entered the world and our lives. Thank you that you would not stand for being separated from your people, but you have done everything necessary to redeem us back, to resurrect us from the pit of death in our sin, to bring us into community and love and acceptance with you. Lord, may we see your grace in the midst of the judgment this morning. In your name, amen. It's what I've chosen to title this morning's message, Grace in Judgment. It's a theme that runs throughout Scripture from the earliest days on through to the very end of days. Grace in the midst of judgment. We're going to see it illustrated today. It wasn't but a couple of years ago that I preached through this portion of Scripture with us. And we took a look at this section that we often refer to as Noah's Ark or Noah and the Flood. And we really zeroed in on the narrative of the flood itself and what was going on in Noah's life and what all took place. Today we're going to take more of a bird's eye view, and we're just going to reach into Scripture and grab a few of the specific points that are on our key theme of seeing God work out this problem of salvation, this problem of sin. What is he going to do about it with people? How is he going to intervene? How is there going to be a rescuer for these people who are broken and are being deeply, radically impacted by sin and its effects? So it'll be up on the screen. You'll be able to follow along with the passages. They're going to be in order. I'm not going to do anything tricky, but rather than reading a large piece up front, we're going to read little portions as we go along with each point, and I'm going to kind of paraphrase the story as we go. Okay, are you ready? Here's, maybe, if it'll work with me. Here's a bit of our overview. This is what we're going to see. God is righteous to judge sin. That's not a very comfortable place to start. Sometimes we think we ought to judge sin. It's, for some of us, it's to a fault. It's built into some of our personalities where sometimes we get called a little more high-strung, and it just seems natural for us to see the faults in others, to be irritated where they've gone astray from our expectations or cultural norms or what feel like the rules. You don't have to embarrass yourself, but do I have any brave people who admit they're rule followers in the room? I'm the only one. There's a few of us rule followers. okay? The world needs some good rule followers, right? To add some stability and some strength. But sometimes it can be our weakness to also lean towards the judgmental side and find fault in others. And sometimes we have to ignore our own fault to justify and feel comfortable with finding faults in others. Well, that's nothing new. It's been going on for a very long time. We're going to see as we walk through this story we're going to see God express his love in the midst of confusion, fear, overwhelming circumstances that are outside of people's control, opposition and discomfort socially. And as God, as the righteous judge, who is the only one who has the right to judge sin, declares justice, judgment, we're going to see in the midst of that his grace and care. So God is righteous to judge sin, but he is also gracious to provide a way of salvation. Amen? Jesus took upon himself the punishment for our sin so that all who trust in him might be forgiven of their sin and be saved from the coming judgment. We're going to see that play out in these early pages of Scripture, and we see that to be the broad story that is still playing out in our day. Okay. You ready to dive in? Turn with me, if you would, to Genesis chapter 6. Genesis chapter 6. So picking up just after where we left off last week, we walked through some little tidbits within the early genealogies of Scripture. Maybe not always the most exciting portion of Scripture, but we see that God was at work there. And what we saw last week is sin is spreading. It's growing. It's affecting everyone, even though there's new generations. And we're looking for this hope that God has promised that a boy, a seed from Eve, would rise up and crush the power of the serpent, the hissing one, would relieve us from this bondage, this oppression, this destruction that we've brought upon ourselves. What we see happening is sin spreading and getting worse, and people gloating about it, and it's destroying things. And now we get to a part in the genealogies where it's not just so-and-so had such and such a child, but now we're getting end dates. And we see that truth that God had declared that death would come from sin is now actually affecting the world. And Adam has died. Now we come to a new character, a new person named Noah. But before we get to talk about Noah, we need to start in verse 5 of chapter 6. So would you read verses 5, 6, and 7 with me? It says, "Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of men was great on the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." The Lord was sorry he had made men on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. The Lord said, "I will blot out man, whom I have created from the face of the land, from man to animals to creeping things and to birds of the sky, for I am sorry I have made them. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. We'll come back to that. A few quick notes as we kind of cruise our way through this. Start off in verse 6. I want you to catch from this overview look that what we see here is that the extreme and natural trajectory, the direction that sin is naturally taking the world and everybody with it, is to total corruption. Okay? Now, in this point of history, by all means, go back and during your week, during the day in your studies, go read some of the context that led up to this between the earliest people, Adam and Eve, and the early generations, and now with Noah. You can read about the sin progression that takes place. But at this point, we see God, I don't want to add words in, but in a sense, almost taking a pause, taking a survey, assessing what's going on. He's fully aware that this sin pattern has been happening. He told them that would be the case. None of it is taking him by surprise, right? And now he looks and he assesses. He sees the truth that no one else is willing to take a look at. He says, I see in the depths of them that all of their motives, that the wellspring, the base core of who man is continually evil. It's coming from a broken place. It's stirring up filth. It's like as if the well had been tainted with pollutants, and now everything that comes out of it is tainted, is broken, is unsafe. What is God to do? We see that in verse 6, the condition that mankind had come to grieved the Lord. There's an interesting word study thing here, and I don't have all of that up on the screen. Some of your translations will have the word repented. It says that God repented of what he had done. Some of them will say that he was grieved, that he was sorrowful, that he was sorry for what he did, depending on what translation you're looking at. It's interesting because the word here, repented, is a right, faithful word. We're used to most of the time in our circles when we talk about repented in the church and when we do word studies on that, we're usually further ahead. We're in the New Testament looking at the Greek understanding of repented, which is very straightforward. It's a mathematical term. It means to turn 180 degrees. So you were going in one direction and making that the pattern of your life, and you stop in a real moment of time, obey the Lord, and move in a completely opposite direction toward him. And so we see math used to give a symbol or an understanding to a spiritual reality. But way back here in the early days, we're looking at a Hebrew description of repentance, and it's very different in its base. It comes from an ancient base word that describes to sigh. You ever been at a place where you look at what your choices have been and what's going on around you, and the first step to bring it all in, to figure out what you need to do, is just to go, that's what it says God did. He stopped. He paused. He looked at the situation that was affecting his people. And he sighed, and there was remorse and concern. And that same word can also reflect to pity something, to be sorry about it, to take pity on it. It's not, God is not saying, man, I messed up. God did not do the wrong thing. Please understand the nature of who God is. He didn't make a mistake. That's not what he's saying here. He's looking at the situation and he is having pity and sorrow on behalf of us. They were wandering in their sinfulness. They were blind to it. Just a few short verses before this, if we backed up to verse 28 of the previous chapter, we would read about this Lamech guy that we talked about last week that was bragging about his sinfulness. That's what the world had come to. All of their motive, all of their thinking was corrupted. And God takes a big breath on our behalf and says, they don't even understand at this point the depths and the impact, the weight of where they're at. What is to be done in this situation? Verse 7. We see that wickedness garners thorough judgment. God says, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to blot it out. I'm going to start over. We're going to do this over again. It's going to be thorough. It's going to affect people. It's going to affect the animals. It's going to affect everything creeping on the ground that he had spent time making and fashioning, right? It's going to be a thorough judgment. It's going to be unlike anything anybody had ever seen. It's not going to be the same as just getting after Cain and teaching him a lesson. It's not going to be the same as just telling Adam and Eve what was going to come from their sin and sending them out of that place, but allowing them to continue. It's going to be very different. But God stops short of it being absolute judgment, doesn't he? It's not everyone. So let's continue. Let's pick up in verse 8. And I accidentally read it ahead of time, but that's okay. It's a beautiful verse. Verse 8. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. Continuing. These are the records of the generations of Noah. Noah was a righteous man, blameless in his time. Noah walked with God. Noah became the father of three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Now we're just doing little excerpts today, so it's not in great detail, but we'll stop there for just a moment. What do we read? God found favor with Noah. Says he was a righteous man in his time. Please understand, this is still before the law. There isn't a lot of specifics that people are being held accountable to, okay? So it isn't that Noah did everything that you and I might imagine as right and perfect. What it's depicting is he had a real relationship with God. And with everything that God chose to hold him accountable to, he was walking in all the light he had. He was walking in relationship consistently and honestly with God. He was righteous before God. And God took favor on him. God provides grace and a means of salvation. Let's look at verses 13 through 14 here, just real quick. Then God said to Noah, "The end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with the violence because of them, and behold, I am about to destroy them with the earth." Sounds very similar to when he was talking to Cain and he talks about the blood of Abel crying out from the ground. Similar here. I see, I observe, I hear what's going on and I'm going to take action, he says. Verse 14, make for yourself an ark of gopher wood. You shall make the ark with rooms and shall cover it inside and out with pitch. We're not going to continue into all the detail about making the ark and all of those things today. We're going to stick on this central theme. God provides a means of grace, a means for salvation in the midst of the judgment. So here he is declaring to Noah, I'm going to take action. I see what's going on, and it is time to hold the sin accountable. It's going to be thorough. It's going to be severe. No one is going to escape. But here's what I want you to do. You're going to build a boat. It's going to be a good size boat. I'm going to tell you how to do it. If you'll trust me, I'm going to use it for you and your family, and there will be salvation in the midst of turmoil, in the midst of the judgment. Continue just a little bit further. I got to turn the page. Turn with me over to starting with verse 17. 17 down through the end of the chapter. I'm going to read a little bit of how God establishes his covenant with Noah. Verse 17. Behold, I am bringing the flood of water upon the earth to destroy all flesh in which the breath of life from under heaven, everything that is on the earth shall perish. But I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall enter the ark, you and your sons and your wife and your sons' wives with you. And of every living thing of all flesh, you shall bring two of every kind into the ark to keep them alive with you. Then you shall be male and female. Of the birds after their kind, and of the animals after their kind, of every creeping thing of the ground after its kind, two of every kind will come to you to keep them alive. As for you, take for yourself some of all food which is edible, and gather it to yourself, and it shall be for food for you and for them. Thus Noah did according to all that God had commanded him. So he did. Okay. My goal is not to get overly political here, but there's some important things real quick. We want to see the big picture that God establishes his covenant with Noah and is providing a way to preserve, and I'm choosing to use this word, it's a teaching word, the remnant. That's a word that we use in theology, in Bible study a lot, because it's a theme that we see throughout Scripture, that even in times, and it starts right here, it started with Adam and Eve, but right here is a great, great early picture of this idea, that when there are times that God, in his righteousness, must take action and declares judgment on sin, he is always faithful to his promises, and he is always faithfully protecting and preserving a remnant. A remnant, I said the word wrong. He's always protecting a small group that are remaining close to him, that he uses as a seed for the next generation, that he continues his covenant and his promises through, that he builds up as an example to others. An imperfect example, an example that still has sin affecting their lives. Later on, we're going to see that with Noah. Even after God's great grace and saving work, Noah still stumbles. He's still impacted by sin. The whole world is. But God is preserving this remnant. Here in the story, we see that he's going to do that by promising. He establishes a covenant, an unbreakable bond by God to Noah and his family. He is going to protect them and bring them in. They're going to be his seed of mankind to the next generation to continue this process. And along with that, he charges them. They're going to bring with them the necessary beginning tools, the stuff needed to reseed the earth, including two of every kind of the animals, the creatures of the earth that would not survive in the flood. He's going to do this. I'm going to hit this really quick and I'm going to move on. We find it interesting in these early days, whether it be back in the creation of the world or right now when God speaks to Adam and Eve, God is the one who establishes this idea that we see true physically and see playing through in the world, in reproduction, and in God's purposes in the world, of there being within each kind of living creature, there being male and female, and that that serves a very important, divinely ordained role in God's plan and purposes. It's not something people came up with one day as a fun idea that we thought would be cool. It's not something that is by us or for us to be manipulated or played with at a whim. It is something that God built into his creation and belongs to him and him alone. I hope I've said enough. That's what we see in these early, early days. And that unfolds over and over again through history. Let's keep going with our main point. I'm going to head into chapter 7 now for a bit. We're going to hit 7 and 8 here pretty quickly. Come on. There we go. Starting in chapter 7... let's see, we want to pick up in verse 11 through 13 here. It says, in the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, on the seventh day of the month, on the same day, all the fountains of the great deep burst open, and the floodgates of the sky were open. The rain fell upon the earth for 40 days and 40 nights. On the very same day, Noah and Shem and Ham and Japheth, the sons of Noah, and Noah's wife and the three wives of his sons with them, entered the ark. We'll stop there.
If we were to keep reading a little bit, one of my favorite parts is, and God shut them up, or God shut the door. He's very active. He's very present in all of this. The note that I made is that God chose to work through what I'm going to call a supernatural disaster. We talk about, in our time, natural disasters, things that happened through the processes of the created world. And when they seem big and devastating and out of control, especially when they affect human beings, then we call them natural disasters. It's something destructive. It's something that causes effects that are damaging to us. Well, this is a big one. This is the first one. This is one that affected the entire world. We've never seen its like before or since. We can go to any portion of the globe and see effects of the worldwide flood. I know there's debate on that and how to interpret it. I understand that. But we see it as fitting in a Christian worldview with exactly what Scripture says. That's why we can go on hikes to the top of Mount Hood and find things like fossils of shells and sea creatures. We believe it comes from this very reality. God did a catastrophic thing in the world and caused, as it says, I don't understand all of this other than what I've taught and read a bit, but that in the creation of the world, God closed up land around waters. And we see here that he breaks that forth. And there were strongholds, there were places of waters in the depth that now God releases out. There's earthquakey sort of stuff. It doesn't say that exact word, so I'm giving a bit of interpretation here. But the world is breaking apart. It's letting out these waters. At the same time, we see early on that there is a mist, that there is a cloud, that there is water in the skies described, which also fits a lot with science and what we observe that would have protected and created a certain type of climate in the world. And that is let loose. That is allowed to fall, and it rains for 40 days. What I'm trying to describe here is whatever it was big. Everything was being shaken up, stirred up, broken loose. It was unlike anything the world has ever known. It was terrible in a human perspective, a human sense for life. You can imagine the sounds. You can imagine the chaos. You can imagine the fear. I have described before, I've made this note before, and I'll hit it and move on quickly. I find it interesting that we pattern classical children's decorations off of the largest worldwide disaster that we've ever known. It's an interesting thing. We use a catchphrase, rightfully so, sometimes after major world events where we say, we will not forget. We shall not forget. And truly, we ought not forget this moment that so clearly illustrated and dealt with the depths of the impact of sin. It was huge. Okay, I'll keep moving. Let's go to verses 15 and 16 of chapter 8 here real quick. It says, then God spoke to Noah, saying, go out of the ark, you and your wife and your sons' wives with you. There's a whole process in between here that I skipped of what took place on the ark, and then a process of God letting them know and helping them to find out when it was safe to go out, when the ground was ready. The ship had settled on the tops of the mountains, and they had gone through a process of releasing birds to find out, had anything started yet? Were there trees growing and whatnot? When the time was right, we're told here that God called them out. He tells them when to come out of the ark and to begin the process of reestablishing the earth. My note is, God delivered Noah and his family through the storm and brought them out to start again. We see that remnant preserved. Can I go a little bit devotional just for a moment here? What about in our lives? What about in our sinfulness? I know God is gracious, and because you're all sitting here, none of us have had eternal punishment for our sin that we've received. I understand that. But all of us are sinners. We've all experienced sin. We've all brought it upon ourselves in the past. And I'm trusting that many of you listening, participating, and here with me this morning are familiar with repentance. And you've exercised that. And you have experienced the grace and the forgiveness and the reconstruction of God in your lives. And that God loves to take that which was broken, even still has brokenness, and rebuild and reestablish and reseed and do things new and fresh and bring life from where there has been and really where there should be only death. God brings newness. That's what he does here. He takes this seed pod of a boat and parks it in the place of his choosing. And he calls them out and says, okay, it's time for me to replant you, to start things up again. Now, I love what we see happen next in our last little note here. So let's go on to verses 20 through the end of chapter 8, and that's where we'll finish our reading this morning. It says, then Noah built an altar to the Lord and took of every clean animal and of every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar. The Lord smelled the soothing aroma, and the Lord said to himself, I will never again curse the ground on the accounts of man, for the intent of man's heart is evil from his youth, and I will never again destroy every living creature as I have done. While the earth remains, seed time and harvest, and cold and heat, and summer and winter, and day and night shall not cease. We see here, and we would see if we backed up a little bit, that God, in the next chapter that I think we're coming to next week, we see that God establishes a symbol of his covenant reestablished with Noah. But here I want us to see as they're coming off the ark, as they're responding to God's grace, his provision, and now his direct call to come out to start up again, what do they do first? They enter into a time of worship. Noah, the broken but righteous man, leads his family, leads these folks in worship. They could be very bitter. Couldn't they have responded to God that way? They could be really fearful. Maybe they just had a lot of more skills in survival back then. But if I were to take me right now and put myself in those shoes, I'm like, God, did you forget the supply store? Like, where am I going shopping? Where's the real estate agent? How's this going to work? We're on our own. I don't know about you, but I like doing work projects with my children. I don't know that they turn out the best and the most skillfully. Sometimes I'm like, well, how about give me one of my buddies who has more experience and knows how to do these things? Let me let them take on the leadership responsibility, the know-how. Anybody else like me that you like somebody else who knows what they're doing to kind of lead the way? Noah's the dad in this case. He's got him and his three boys and their families and what might come from that. I don't know what age they are. Noah's old, so his sons are adults. Hopefully they're very capable. They're starting, it's a weird world. You ever watch the old TV show Survivor back in the day? Ever watch that? Where they maroon these contestants on some island or some portion of tropical land or something somewhere, right? And then they got to figure out, what are we going to do? Where are we going to get food from? Where are we going to sleep? All these kinds of things. How are we going to protect ourselves from the elements? That's what Noah's having to do. But where do they start? They start by stacking up and building an altar, sacrificing animals to the Lord. Evidently, Noah either had a great idea or a conversation with God that we don't know about, or remembers the stories from when he was a kid, learning about great-great-great-great-grandpa Abel, who had done the right thing and had offered sacrifices to the Lord with the right heart, in the right way, and that God had found favor on him before he had been killed by his brother. Somewhere he had picked up some good things, and he worshiped the Lord. God receives the worship of the Lord. It's described here in poetic terms. There's a lot of poetry I'm going to draw your attention to here. In poetic terms of this sweet aroma coming before the Lord. I don't know that that's because there's anything particularly wonderful about roasted animal parts to God, but often it's described this way in the Old Testament. So I'm going to take it at its word. I think God is breathing, my interpretation, you can wrestle with this as you will. I think God is breathing in more than the smell of sacrifices. I think he's breathing in the smell of sacrifices. I think he's drinking in the right heart, the cleanness, the fresh start here, the right attitude of Noah and perhaps his family as well. And once again, almost it's the positive form of that repentance that we read about before. There's a moment with his people. And he adds to the covenant that he's already established with them this promise. This promise that he's never going to do it this way again. He's not going to eat, no matter how bad sin builds back up to, he's not going to do this worldwide, catastrophic, flood wiping out, starting over event again. What about the end, Pastor Nathan? Don't we read about God doing big things? Yes, there will be one more time at the final end. It's not going to be done in the same way, but there's one more time when everything is going to be done away with so that God can do the final end, the final build, right? The final calling in to his presence. But he establishes this promise on top of his covenant that he's not going to do it this way again. And I don't know if it's because God actually said it this way, or if it is Noah in his writing. We believe Noah is the one who penned Genesis for the people. Not Noah, Moses, sorry. I don't know if it's something that he took that was now remaining in the culture and saying, hey, this is how we got this. But this last little part here is a poem. Maybe you see the difference in the writing in your scripture. Where it says, while earth remains, suntime and harvest and cold and heat and summer and winter and day and night shall not cease. Doesn't have the same sound in English. But this is a beautiful poem that's written that locked into the culture, that became a part of the central worldview from the early, early days to travel with the people and be a promise to them and an understanding. You can hear tones of this way, way later when Solomon is writing in Ecclesiastes about how everything has a season and a time and a place under heaven. Where's he getting that kind of ideology from? Well, it's observation of the world, but it's hearkening back to these early, early promises that God has established. Why can you and I, as believers today, with all the turmoil that has come through ages to the world, empires and kings and the good ones and the bad ones, the difficult seasons in our life, why can we wake up and have joy and confidence? One, because we serve the all-powerful God. And two, because he has promised things like this. We can trust that we're coming into fall now, and things are going to change, and winter is going to come unless God comes first. And after that will come the spring, and then will come the summer, and the sun is going to rise, and it's going to set. Why? Why do we have this confidence? God has promised that he will preserve this natural order. God is at work. He shows grace in the very midst of the judgment. He preserves the remnant. He expresses his love and care. The judgment is extreme. I don't know how many the count was for people on the earth at the time, but we only have record of 8 people surviving it. That's real small for any major event. It's huge. I don't want us to miss that and the significance here. But God has not turned his back. As much as it might seem that might. What would it have been like to be there at the time? I'm getting off into fantasy land a bit. I can't imagine not being with Noah and his family in this moment and receiving the physical representation of judgment for my sin in a way that is beyond all overcoming, where there is no hope. It's a big thing. And yet we claim and we observe that God is good even in the midst of judgment. While God says he will never do it this same way again, rest assured that God still holds sin accountable. And he is patient, he is good, he is gracious, he has not yet removed his spirit from this earth. He's here with us. And yet we do see that he allows judgment to take place individually and on a larger scale from time to time and in various ways. And he promises that when the time comes, all sin will be held accountable. And we will make account to God for what we have done with our lives and with him, the grace of his Son. So with that note, let me give our last summary point here. I chose this week to call it the good news. This is kind of a rough story. Again, we're in the early days looking at original sin and the fallout as sin built to this tidal wave, this tsunami of effect on the world, which literally got represented as water overcoming the world. So what's the good news? Well, like I said at the beginning, if we can look through the story and keep our eyes on that resurrected king, who at the time of this story is way in the future still to come, right? What do we see? Because Jesus has provided salvation from our sins as an act of grace toward us, we see that in the story. He did that for them. And how much more so he has done for us through his death and resurrection. Therefore, we declare the gospel, the good news, with great humility and compassion toward sinners in great need of a Savior. we see in the midst of judgment and the need, the rightfulness of judgment, that God is good and gracious, and that there is a message of salvation, that He has provided it. He's done everything to make it available to you. And you and I get to be the continued mouthpieces. We get to bring notice. We get to draw attention to God's saving grace. Will you join in the mission? Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we thank You and we praise You. I recognize that this room is full of people who have heard these stories many times, and we accept these things. But the truth is, Lord, this is hard stuff to receive and accept. It's uncomfortable. It's scary. It can be overwhelming. The weight, the cost, the destruction from our sin is far more than what we're willing or maybe even have the capacity to accept on a day-to-day basis. Lord, truly, sin is still leading back to that total corruption. It strives to those ends in each one of us. Truly, we need You as the Savior, the cleanser, the rebuilder, the one who brings life and sets us free. Thank You for being our King and our Lord and our Rescuer. Lord, now that we've received that and accepted, and as we stumble along as best as we can follow Your instruction and Your leading, God, help us to have tender hearts of mercy towards those who have not yet believed. Not getting in meaningless, worthless arguments. Not beating people up in our words and our slogans and our opinions. But truly with hearts of compassion, building friendships that matter. Extending kindness and grace and mercy just like You, and boldly proclaiming the truth. And yes, at times, Lord, when we have the relationship, when we have the opportunity, when we have the freedoms within our country, holding people accountable to their sin and their and the decisions and the destruction that may come from it. Lord, I'm not trying to be political, but I still pray in this day that Christians would exercise their right to vote in this country, that we would hold lawmakers and leaders and folks accountable, not out of anger and to hurt or to embarrass, but to protect and be engaged in Your continuing grace to the world. Ultimately, Lord, we look forward to being gathered with You in Your presence for all of eternity. And we want that turnout, we want that call to be as large and as magnificent as possible. Thank You for giving us a role to play. We love You, Lord Jesus. In Your name, amen. Well, each one of us, I know, has deserved judgment at times in our lives. I pray that you would keep short accounts and repent to the Lord and understand in the midst of judgment, God brings grace. Go in His grace. You are dismissed.